Evening, wherever, whichever time zone you are in, I'm glad that you are able to join this conversation on transforming access to healthcare in India. We've got a very distinguished panel with us. Hopefully, they'll be able to shed a lot of insights and answer questions that you have. I am Sarang Dev. I'm faculty at the Indian School of Business. I also serve as the executive director of its healthcare institute, the Max Institute of Healthcare Management. And my research has been dominantly in healthcare delivery systems. We've got with us Amit Mukim. He is management consultant. He heads the South Asia practice of IQVR, which is a global healthcare technology. He's a long career in consulting. He was with KPMG before. He's a graduate in economics from University of Kolkata, MBA from FMS Delhi. So Amit, welcome. We've got Dr. Shuchin, who is founder director of Ujala Cygnus Hospitals. He also serves on boards of several national NGOs as their advisor on health programs. Ujala Cygnus has been a very prominent partner of PMJY scheme, has done a lot of interesting things, used PMJY coverage to expand care, provide access to care to a lot of patients in smaller towns in the country. So we'll hear from his experiences. And then we've got Sandeep Kapila, who is the co-founder of Swasth Foundation. He was with McKinsey before he started Swasth. He worked there for 6-7 years trying to design new health systems and then sort of took those learnings into development of Swasth, which runs a chain of low-cost hospitals, chains, clinics in Mumbai. And he has also recently developed a lot of interest and expanded services into health and wellness. So we'll get that perspective from Sandeep. So welcome all of you. It's great to be on the same panel. We've got a very good sort of diverse set of viewpoints that I want to bring into our discussion today. Amit, I'll start with you. You have been involved in PMJY and NHA right from the inception, from the early days. So I would say you've got a ringside view, but also at times you must have had to step inside the ring to make sure that everything is working okay. You know, I think it's you know, for the audience of this panel discussion, it's clear what impact PMJ or NHA is trying to have, what sort of changes are coming. But from your perspective, if you can point out to one or two factors that you think have worked very well, whatever the original intent of PMJ was, we can already see those changes or that impact being realized. If we can start on that note.
Sure. And very good morning, everyone. So glad to be part of this. Dr. Sarang, I wanted to take an analogy here, even to liven up the discussion. So imagine building up a spacecraft, and we are told that we have to build all of that with Indian components. We don't have astronauts. The spacecraft has taken off, and then there are lots of asteroids on the way, right? So this is exactly what I feel we are faced with. I'm very proud as an organization to have been part of such an initiative, right? And by no means it's a simple effort, because we are dealing with 31 different types of healthcare systems multiplied by two, plus the municipal corporations, plus the private sector, right? And in no country, something like this exists. So I remember when you know, the task first started, and we were scouting across for best practices across the world, we realized we have to build our own best practice. So that's number one. I think what's worked really well is you know, the way the vision of the scheme has been laid out, and how the execution rollerblades have been put in place. And what took off to a slow start, because each state had its own health system, its own health scheme, it was by no means easy to harmonize it. I think the patience is paying off, where you have more than 18 states now who are rolling out the next version of NHA, and including taking part in the National Digital Health Mission, which is the whole highway for technology. So that's one. I think number two is we do have a proven number of cases and case volumes that are now coming through. What is, at the same time, let me balance this statement. I do not think that we have the full participation of the healthcare system And why I say that is we still have a big chunk of the private healthcare system not fully aligned with this for various reasons. And we can get into that as we move along. One of the big reasons being the economic model needs to be still sorted out. This is not a PPP model for roads and tolls. It is much more complex. That's one. Second piece is, and I think that maybe the pandemic will help us look through it much better, is that we have a broken primary healthcare system, right? And if we do not fix that and integrate it well, we'll never be able to achieve a cost-effective model. And I think that their work needs to be done. I know that there are efforts underway, but we are building the system from top down, right? And I think that somewhere it's like meeting two rails together and connecting them. And I just feel that we need to keep that in cognizance and not lose sight while we are chasing the entire hospitalization-based care, because then it will not achieve the objective. So I'll pause here, Dr. Sarang, but these are my initial reactions and glad to be part of this.
Perfect. Thanks, Amit. It actually brings out a lot of threads that we want to pursue through the discussion. One is engagement of private sector in flagship programs such as PMJ. And we'll go to Dr. Shuchin about that part. And then the second is about how much do we want to put emphasis on tertiary care versus primary care? And hopefully Sandeep will shine some light on that as well. But before I go to them, just a quick follow-up question, if you don't mind, Amit. We know that IQVIA has strong skills in data analytics, right? And so I wanted to also understand that aspect, because PMJ and NHJ is serving another purpose, right? It is the first time when a lot of data at the national level is coming together. And if you can highlight for the audience what kind of insights is one able to generate now and how that is informing program design, that will be great.
Sure, Dr. Sarang. So look at the whole system sitting on four data pillars, right? One pillar is data and the registry of all healthcare facilities. And that is something we were also part of, and that's been built out. An entire census of every healthcare facility and an ID tagging of everything has been done. So that's number one. Number two is a registry of doctors, right? Which is still under progress, because there I think nobody on this panel even may know that how many doctors do we have practicing who are registered, right? So I think that's something which is still being worked through. I think the third thing is the registry of drugs, all of the molecules and everything else, which needs to be put in place to be able to link the pathways to outcomes and to different things, right? And the fourth is really disease-specific registries. Maybe it's across cancer and other diseases which need specific registries to be maintained for everyone to participate. So that's one. And I think, the current construct of how the NHA and the NDHM is being put together rests on the bedrock of these four pillars. And these are in progress, which is a great development. I think the second piece is you may have the data, but then how do you create the connectivity or the standards for data to talk to each other, which then depends on how you bring in various systems which are sitting both in public and private hospitals, and many hospitals which do not even have systems to pull and talk, right? So there are standards which the government has really thought through, which are SNOMED City standards. And now there is work going on to build a common architecture, right, for all of these platforms and a sandbox. So the NDHM has created a sandbox where private players and technology companies can register their software and work through standards. So that's number two. I think number three is what role does each stakeholder play in this? And I think there's a lot of clarity that is coming through, of course, because there are considerations of data privacy, there are considerations of independence, there are considerations of competitiveness that needs to be on an equal playing field. And I think there the thought process is that the government has to be the custodian of this core as it plugs through and create an open architecture for private companies, digital health companies, and other players to plug in and interplay on standards and have a choice whether a patient works through this pathway or works outside this pathway. So I think that's where we are. There's still a lot of unanswered questions, but I feel that we are going in a particular direction, which somewhat makes sense. I think some of the nuts and bolts still need to be worked through.
Now, I think what we tend to forget sometimes looking at things from outside is we are always thinking about algorithms and machine learning and artificial intelligence, but the basic data infrastructure, do we have registries, do we have directories, And that's grunt work. But unless you do that, it is going to be very difficult to do any icing on the cake later. So really appreciate that comment. Thank you. Dr. Shujin, I'll come to you next. Amit already sort of hinted at this issue that the response from private sector, you know, given the private sector itself is so heterogeneous, the response is not likely to be homogeneous. But I wanted to hear from your side. You've been very active in PMJY. What has worked for you and how do you see this going forward?
See, I think as we were discussing in the just before the panel started, we have been the champions of Ayushman Bharat since the very beginning. Since the scheme was launched, we understood very quickly that this scheme was meant for organizations like us. See, when you see the 5 A's of healthcare, when we started out, there was no availability of tertiary healthcare in these small towns that we started out in. If you were unfortunate enough to have a heart attack in a town like Kethal, you had no choice but to hire a jeep and travel towards Chandigarh to access healthcare, and that may take you 4 hours or 6 hours depending on the road conditions and the traffic and the whatever, right? So when we started out, there was no availability of a cath lab or a cardiologist at all in those small towns. But when we, even after we have started out, it's not like we are being overwhelmed with the number of cases coming in, because the affordability is still, as Sandeep also said in the beginning, is very subjective. What we may say is very affordable may be very expensive to some of the communities that we work with. And since we are a social enterprise, we are supposedly for profit, right? So even though we don't make too much profits, but we do have to sustain ourselves. We don't get any grants. I think Ayushman Bharat and PMJY have come as a blessing for people like us. So we would have had to treat patients for free, because our ethos is very clear that we will not turn away any patient due to financial reasons. It is a fireable offense in our organization if somebody says that this patient was sent back because he could not pay. So at least, if we are doing that for free now, if the government is ready to pay even a small part of that cost, that works very well for us. So I think the private organizations have to now realize that this will be the way going forward. You cannot expect to be charging, market rates for at least emergency treatments, because there's a lot of angst within the population, that within the communities, if you turn away a patient in an emergency and then something happens to the patient on the road, and ethically also it is not right. So with the continual expansion of Ayushman Bharat, I think it will be a reality going forwards that more and more organizations will have to work with it. And we need to make ourselves more efficient, make our processes more efficient, get down our costs as much as possible, make sure that we work on volumes of scale. So like in our hospitals, almost none of our doctors work on a fee-for-service basis. Everyone mostly is on fixed salaries with a very, very small variable component. That helps us in three or four things. One, of course, is this fact that we can treat patients who are unable to pay very easily, because the doctors do not have a incentive. They won't say that, why should I treat this patient? I'm not getting anything for this. So we are able to treat all these patients. Second, once we hit a certain volumes, then after that, a lot of the revenue starts flowing into the bottom line, because we do not have any variable payout components. And third, and the most important, the reason why we started out with this was it disincentivizes the doctors from doing any unnecessary interventions. They are not incentivized to operate on the patient or do unnecessary procedures on the patient because they have a fixed salary. So it helps in the ethical treatment of the patients quite a lot. But of course, this fee for service model is now being perpetuated by schemes like PMJY. That is another discussion altogether, how it misaligns the incentives of the doctors and the patients completely, this insurance model. But we have to work with what we have. We do not have any capitation or outcome models yet. I hope that the government and the NHA will look forward at going with some of the models, at least on a pilot scale. We are already talking to some insurance companies to start at least a pilot in some of our locations that we are working with.
Oh, perfect. Thank you, Dr. Shuchin. Lot of important points made there. What I took away from that comment is you got to rethink the operating model, right? I think, and one of the key components of the operating model is physician engagement models that exist in India. Those may not work in this new kind of a regime. You may have to think through. And I'm glad that you mentioned Kaithal. By the way, it turns out that when I was doing some research in rural Punjab, Kaithal was the place to go. But what you're saying is even Kaithal has, you know, lack of access, and people have to go from there somewhere else. So that gives us an idea of the difficulties that people face in interior parts of the country. I will come back to you on sort of more operational innovation ideas. And it's also good that you've already brought out that one fee-for-service model is sort of being replaced by another fee-for-service, or at least quasi. And what is the journey from here to value-based care? So it's not that we only want to increase access to care. There's a lot of access, right? But is access to high-quality care? And are we able to reward value? And are we able to disincentivize destruction of value, which happens throughout the healthcare system? So we'll pick on some of those themes. Thank you for your opening thoughts. Sandeep, I'll come to you next. You have been working on the primary care end of things for many years now in urban areas. And, you know, one initial thought people may have is you operate in Mumbai. What's the dearth of healthcare in Mumbai? There's so many providers. So what sort of additional value have you been able to bring to the table? And what gaps do you still see in that space? If you can start with that first.
Yeah, sure. So our history is that we did start with rural Maharashtra. We started with micro insurance pilots there when RSPY was just coming. And I think sort of the model of that is PMJ that we see today getting extended. And the first thing we learned in our pilot there in rural Maharashtra was the fact that without primary care, any insurance, micro insurance, or any secondary tertiary care is only going to result in inflation of cost. Our data across 20,000 odd lives that we had insured showed us that 50% of hospitalization was preventive. And we just had a very clear comparison, because we had, out of the 20,000, I think 10,000 we were able to provide primary care access, and 10,000 we couldn't provide. So it became like a post facto, you can say, trial of people with primary care, without primary care, having insurance. And the incidence rate was half where we had primary care, like 6% here and 12% there. It was that clear data. So that told us that primary care is what we need to work on. And in India, primary care was disorganized, is still completely almost disorganized. There's no structure around that. So we started with that situation. We said, okay, why make our life tougher? We already have a tough life. Why make it tougher by trying to do it in rural first? Let's solve it in urban, because it's not like this problem is solved in urban or even in Mumbai for that matter, right? So for example, when we did survey in Mumbai, we found only 8% of people go to public system for primary care. And this is with Mumbai, I think, having the densest PHC network. The municipal PHC network, I think, is the densest in Mumbai compared to any other city in India. And there it was just 8%. So 92% people were going to primary care, going to private providers. These were people, doctors who were in, again, slums. But these were, again, in Mumbai, the enforcement being higher, they were all certified degree doctors who were legally allowed to practice medicine. Other cities, we know who are practicing medicine in the interior parts of the city, in the low-income communities, right? So anybody with anything is basically practicing there. But as we dug deeper, you can see that basically primary care, there is no system. It just works on the physician. The physician's incentive or sources of income, when we started understanding that, we realize close to 70 to 80% of the physician's income doesn't come from the patient directly. So what the patient pays the physician is a very small amount. So he keeps a very small consultation fee of 30 rupees, but the rest of the income is coming from either commissions through the pathology lab, through hospitals where you would refer them for surgeries or admissions, or through medicine prescriptions, through the pharmacy or the pharma company, either of those, right? So essentially, 70 to 80% of the cost which is paid by the patient is inflated. It's not the cost, it's just access fee or a referral fee. And I think that gave us an indication that if we can build a model out in, first, let's start with Mumbai, where we can standardize care, we can work on standard treatment guidelines, protocols, improve the quality of care, make it value-based, as you said. And that's how we started in Mumbai. We've had an interesting journey. We've gone to other cities, found that this can be scaled. It's quite flexible and movable across, that the model works in other states. We tried it in Ahmedabad, for example. And I think the most important learnings, though, from that, what now, after doing all this, what we have learned, I think the key thing for me, takeaway still, is the fact that in India, 80% of healthcare expenditure is out of pocket today, right? The patient is paying at the time of availing service. Today, still 70 to 80% is still that. And so he's hence a consumer. He's actually paying like a consumer. But practically, there is no protection for that consumer. What happens with that money? There is no accountability. There is a Consumer Protection Act under which he can work, but that is so complicated that no judge in that system knows what is happening, right? He just relies on another doctor to validate what is being said. And the fact is, not a, I think, single doctor has been penalized, at least till a few years ago, under this, right? So practical accountability, practical contract is actually not there from a primary care definitely standpoint. And for the low income, where in general access to justice is low, you can imagine how the system works. So what we tried through that, and that's been our biggest learning, is to develop standardized contracts for the patient, between the patient and provider, like standardize it. And we call it like a warranty, because that's what I think patients understand. We get warranty for everything right now, mobile phone, laptop, TV, fridge, everything. And I'm paying so much for a healthcare service, I don't get a warranty, I don't get any assurance. So for us, warranty is an assurance that, of course, it's not that it won't go wrong. Even when we buy a mobile phone, it can go wrong. It's an assurance that if you are not satisfied at the end of it, or if a problem is redeveloping, you don't get the solution that you seek, then we are with you and we will treat the further solution for free. And we've done that now in dental for the last 6 years. Great success, very, very welcome by patients. And we have had a very smooth ride. It's allowed us to, for the patients to come back to us and not hop on to another person, right? Which is part of the problem, right? Antibiotic resistance develops because one doctor, they are not satisfied, they go to the next. So they come back to us. We are able to work, continue with them and support them in the right way. So in short, yeah, I think that's like been a journey of why primary healthcare, where we are. And now we are doing, as we'll talk later, a little bit more about the wellness piece, because we think there is more to primary care again than what doctors alone can.
Yeah. I'll come to the wellness piece in a few minutes, Sandeep. Thank you for that. And again, what we are seeing is you need some innovations on the ground. Because of the, as we say, incomplete market, this contract between the patient and the provider is, you know, incomplete, information asymmetry. So while overall at the national level, probably there are insurance schemes coming up, but at the ground level, one may have to do small innovations to reduce the friction in the market. I mean, you have your hand up, so I'm going to go to you and I have a question for you after you finish your comment.
Yes, sure. Thank you. You know, I just wanted to add to what Sandeep was saying, because I have known about Sandeep's organization since its very beginning and have tremendous respect for the work they are doing. There are two or three things, Arang, and I'll link it to the first question you asked me. Now, Sandeep is gone and trying to build out a healthcare model where you have no idea of how that community has existed and how that community behaves, number one. So there's no data, right? And, you know, extrapolate that to many, many micro communities that are there. The second is, in that particular ecosystem, it's not just a question of managing health, but it's a question of building awareness and looking at other aspects that determine health as well, which is a quintessential model that we really have to think through if we have to build out the healthcare system actually at a scale that will sustain. And I think the third thing, and Sandeep, maybe we'll chat about it, I think the whole perception of this primary care is paise nahi bante hain, right? It's an unprofitable CSR business, et cetera, and people have stayed away from it. And I think that, you know, we need to figure out a way that, we have certain organized interventions in this, whether or not people look at it as true profit, because to me, it can never be true profit, but it can still be economically viable if the strings are tightened up and run in the right way. I mean, you are closer to this business, but to me, what you are doing is actually something we should really sit and think about on how we scale up.
Yeah, Amit, thanks for that comment. And it is actually an important point. I was going to come back to Sandeep on this because primary care clinics and chain of clinics has also been a graveyard of many startups in India. They've tried, they've had good ideas, but I think the reality is far more complex. If I can use that thread, actually go to Dr. Shuchin for a moment. Have you ever thought about primary care? What's the role of outpatient primary care in your model? And where would you see or would you want to see the partnership with Ayushman Bharat go? Because, you know, Ayushman Bharat has two arms. One is the tertiary care, and the primary care, though, is all health and wellness centers within the public health system. Where do you see that going, and where would you want it to go?
Absolutely, and totally agree with Amit's point on how to make sure that it is economically sustainable. And we've seen that model in various countries, I think, enough to learn a lot from it. As I said, currently what happens is that in this fee-for-service model, unfortunately, in primary and preventive care, there is no incentive to the doctor to, you know, really take care of it. The incentive lies in tertiary care only. So my hospital's incentive, you may say, or the cardiologist who's working there's incentive is, you have the heart attack, you come to me, I'll put in a stent. So, you know, we may charge you 5 lakh rupees if you're coming to a very big hospital, or if we may charge you 60,000 rupees if you're coming through Ayushman Bharat, but you have to have that heart attack to you know, make the cardiologist earn that money. Nobody's incentivizing the cardiologist to work on the primary and preventive aspect of it to make sure you do not have that heart attack, right? The community's incentive obviously is not to have it. Whenever we set up a cardiology center, a cath lab in these small towns, the entire town turns up and I always ask the same question. Would you rather not have the heart attack, or would you have a heart attack and be treated very well with this, you know, German machine that we're installing here? And unsurprisingly, everybody says, no, we don't want to have that heart attack. But who is incentivizing the doctors for that is the problem, right? The PMJY is definitely not, but hopefully the second arm, the health and wellness centers, may. That is what we are hoping. Because see, India cannot afford this pay fee for service insurance model that is happening. So India needs the model that Sandeep is building, to have that preventive healthcare, to prevent hospitalization, as he called the 10,000 people he could have prevented. Because the cost of the disease will balloon up exponentially once they start coming to our center. So we do a lot of tertiary care, but at heart I am a preventive care physician. So we run a lot of preventive healthcare clinics in the rural areas, and unfortunately, because we are we have investors on board, it is our fiduciary responsibility to make sure that they don't lose too much money. So we have to run those clinics through a separate not-for-profit foundation that we have called Sehat Foundation, and we do a lot of outreach camps there also. We detect almost, I think, 10 to 15 new diabetics every day who had no idea that they were diabetics. And now see, once you've detected them, it's not costing you much, right? Maximum say 50 rupees for a test and some basic medicine. But now if he is not detected and he comes to our hospital with a diabetic foot, and we are amputating one foot every 30 seconds across the world due to diabetes. What do you think are the costs of the disease, right? It's not just the direct cost of the disease. That is, we may say, oh, we amputated it through Ayushman Bharat, so he did not have to pay anything out of his pocket. And the cost was only 30,000 rupees. If he had gone to a big city hospital, he would have been charged 5 lakh rupees or whatever. But that is not the real cost of the disease, even though it is 30,000 compared to 50. The problem is now he goes back home and loses his job and can't go to the factory because he's lost his foot. So his future, you know, earnings of many, many years are lost. That is the real cost of the disease. And then there is, of course, the intangible cost of the disease, which nobody considers, because now he's lost his job. He will pull his children out of school and send them to work. And many future generations will, you know, lose. One of my colleagues in the organization I work in, Ujala Cygnus, drives a car. So I sit in that car like 4 or 5 times a week because we travel to hospitals. And he tells me the same thing that, you know, he says, till 6th class, I used to come first in maths and I used to come first in the race also in school. But then my father died and my mother said, now you can't go to school, you come out and start working. So I started working and then I learned driving, and now I'm driving a car for the last many years. If he had continued with education, who knows where he would have been right now, right? So all these causes of disease cannot be prevented by hospitals like us, unfortunately. Primary care has to be the bedrock of everything. And unfortunately, till now, I don't see too much of an effort going into it. Hopefully, the health and wellness centers will prove me wrong. But I don't see how private sector will align towards those centers as well, until and unless, as we said, we do an outcome-based, value-based healthcare model, where Sandeep's organization, for example, or our Sehat clinics are given a certain budget that this village is yours and you have to make sure that they stay healthy. If they have to access any sort of tertiary care treatment, you spend out of that budget. So my responsibility now becomes that they should not have any complications, their diabetes should be controlled, they should not get that heart attack, so I'll make sure they run every day or whatever. So make sure that, you know, I don't have to spend on their angioplasties or on their renal replacement therapies or on their amputations. But I don't know how far that is, but hopefully not very much so.
So good, we'll go there now. So Amit, if you can come in at this time, what we've heard is need to have primary care, comprehensive primary care, right? Not episodic primary care, comprehensive primary care covered, preventive and wellness actions covered. We've also heard from Sandeep that 90%, and his number is from Mumbai, but it's not very different across India, 80-90% of first point of contact for patients is typically private sector, right? Outpatients in private sector. What's the, in your mind, what may be the changes within PMJY or Ayushman Bharat that will allow coverage of primary care and wellness activities beyond what is being already done through government's health and wellness centers? I mean, with anything new, there may be roadblocks. So what roadblocks one would have to overcome to go there? And do you see it happening? So if you can hear your thoughts.
Yeah, sure. No, so, you know, in the last 12 to 18 months, Dr. Sarang, part of it has happened. You know, at IQVIA, when we track data on pharma drug sales, we saw a huge shift in tier 2, tier 3 markets and rural markets. I mean, their growths were 2 to 3 times in some places, metro growth, which means that healthcare buying had shifted and part of it has remained. Now, number one. Number two, break up this whole usage of healthcare services into 3 parts. Consultation with a doctor, doing the test, buying the medicine, right? Now, consultation with a doctor is now geography agnostic, technically, right? So there are ways in which people in Kolhapur are accessing doctors in Mumbai, right? And that is happening today. How the pathway is working forward needs to be broken down and assessed. But the Kolhapur patient is accessing a Mumbai doctor who is prescribing a medicine that is available in a Kolhapur chemist shop, which is also you know, at a certain price point. And so that one loop is closed, right? What is still missing is high quality diagnostics, because the technology has not developed or the model has not developed to actually provide for all of that. And that's where somewhere, you know, the link gets broken, where, you know, we have the same amount of diagnosis that is available, whether it's radio or PATH, closer to the patient in these geographies. And what happens many times is the patient ends up going to a hospital to actually access some of that diagnostics, right? I don't have an answer to that, Dr. Sarang. But, you know, part of the problem remains there with respect to completing the loop on the access. The other two can be taken care of, right? And technology has played a role. Patient behavior has changed where they're no longer running to the clinic or the hospital. Now, we ran another survey last year, and let me share a point with you on patient behavior. Now, this behavior of patients is very, very interesting. And it varies across different age groups, different disease profiles. So we ran a survey where we looked at close to 5,000-6,000 patients on their willingness to go back to a hospital to access care, you know, during the pandemic and post-pandemic, various services. We found the people who had postponed their care, they wanted to go back to the hospital and access the same procedure at the same hospital. However, chronic patients and elderly patients did not want to go to the OPD of the hospital because they were scared that they will actually contract the infection. Mm-hmm. Non-chronic patients wanted to actually go back, you know, and access the care. Telehealth on the hospital setting was not as formulated or as demanded as telehealth outside the hospital setting. So there are nuances of this patient behavior also. And, you know, it's not a plain brush, but you can push through bringing in some of this out. And see, here cost makes a difference, Dr. Sarang, as well as quality. Now, we all know that the availability of healthcare professionals is very skewed, right? And you do need to come to a certain hospital or you need to come to a certain urban area to access a certain specialty. But that barrier can be broken. I think there we need to, and it has happened in different parts of the world where in countries like Africa, et cetera, you have incentivized specialists and physicians in urban areas to actually treat patients for a certain capitation in rural areas. Now, that doesn't exist here. I think there we need to think through how we build cross-geography access and incentivize and disincentivize the system because now technology can actually enable that.
Perfect. I mean, I just want to say at this point, I know Sandeep has a comment. We'll hear from him. Capitation pilots have been tried out, but it now may be a good time to revisit and what may change given the changed settings. Sandeep has run a capitation himself, as he described. I know Sugavaru in Tamil Nadu was run and it had mixed results. So that's, you know, a topic for some time later. Sandeep, I'll go to you for the next comment. And after that, we will open it up for Q&A from the audience. Go ahead.
Yeah, no, I just wanted to share our experience and I think respond to when we start thinking of scaling this up or even how we should think about a larger solution. To me, the crux is to actually shift from this paradigm where we are so dependent on a doctor, diagnostic and medicines, because that's the paradigm which the world has tried. We have very highly developed countries which are facing issues with that because that results in only increase in cost. To me, the fundamental way we have to start, and the fact is also, the fact is that today in India, for example, for hypertension, and we see it in our clinics, we saw it first, that one out of three people who take their medicines regularly, only their blood pressure is in control. So the goal is not to get them to take medicines, but the goal is that their blood pressure should be in control because only then the hospitalization is prevented. The same is true for diabetes. And these are again multiple data which suggest this, right? That only medicines, even getting access to medicines, testing with a doctor prescribing medicines, this is how much it, the best we can get is one out of three. What we need, hence, I think, is what this has shown, even the pandemic and particularly conditions like hypertension, diabetes, that there are other modalities that we need to tap into, which particularly work on our mental health more than the physical directly, right? Which is besides medicines, number one. Number two, I think the need for wellness professionals. So wellness shouldn't be just something we do on the side, but it is as much a professional setup, just like healthcare provision is. So when we talk of doctors, we have a nurse, doctor, specialist, etc. I think wellness needs to be cadreized in some ways or professionalized in the same manner. And that is what will allow wellness professionals to be there at the local level so that we can train people from the local village communities to become the wellness professional of that community. And they can then guide people on how to stay healthy, what is the right diet, what is the exercise, and that doesn't require much for them to do. And that paradigm shift from just saying it's about access to medicines, tests, and doctors, I think has to happen, that we need to be making more available and explore more possibilities of well-being and not just this.
Thanks, Sandeep. I think this is a good way to wrap up our discussion before I open it up for audience. But if I could, you know, sort of distill down what I learned, there is improvement in access thanks to large schemes such as PMJY. A lot of that increase in access has come on tertiary care, which is a welcome move. But we need to also keep in mind what incentives it may create going forward. And we don't want to run our exchequer into bad situation where the tertiary care expenditure is so much, which means we need to scale up other aspects of care, which is, let's say, primary care, but also beyond that, multidisciplinary approach to wellness. And that would require a different way of financing. One may have to look at capitation models or other ways of financing this. So I will pause our discussion there, and there are a lot of questions coming from the audience. One of them is for Amit, the question from Professor Bellare. So you mentioned four pillars, and it seems you missed out, or maybe you want to cover now, where do medical devices, procedures, etc. come in? You talked about diagnostics, so you know devices are clearly an important component. Yes,
the pillars were around data, Dr. Sarang. I think on devices and procedures, it's a lot about standards, right? So we all would be aware, and I think again, we are late there, is the HTA, Health Technology Assessment Initiative, that is going on on the medical device front, right? Where we are trying to create standards and integrate that. And at some point, I think in a few years down the line, we will have the HTA body as well as the principles around medical devices. I think on the procedures, and this is my personal view, there's a lot to be done. And I think standardization does not exist, whether it's private or public, right? It is very, very physician-driven. It is very clinician-driven. It is very hospital-driven. And I think, when we look at even sharing of outcomes, sharing of data, even before Ayushman Bharat time, I don't think that has happened, right? And I think there somewhere, we need to have a body or a mechanism where for certain procedures and certain diseases, because then COVID taught us that, I don't want to belabor, but COVID taught us that, the same protocol could be treated differently and it could reduce, hospital admissions or distress ICU admissions, right? And insurers then started pushing for it. So somewhere the payer pushed for different care protocol during pandemic. And I think somewhere we'll have to think through that, but who bites the bullet there? I think that's a big question.
Yeah. Thanks, Amit. There are questions around scale-up. We talked about sustainability, but people are asking questions on scale-up. Let me first ask Dr. Shuchin. You run several hospitals, so there has been some amount of scale-up. But based on the financial model of your hospitals in the presence of PMJ, what would it take for you to scale up, 5 times, 10 times? And, are there changes that need to be made in the ecosystem to enable that? And after that, I'll go to Sandeep.
Yes. So we have 15 hospitals now in 4 states of North India. Of course, it's taken a lot of effort and a lot of time to scale this up. We've been in this for the last 10 years. We started in 2011. And it's been a journey that has seen many ups and downs. I think the luckiest break that we got was that we got some good investors on board very early into the journey. First, some angels came in, and then we went through 4 private equity rounds till today. And luckily, all of our investors have been very understanding of the fact that this model is a long play. It's not like you get your fund out in the 5-year life that most other funds would be looking at. So I think understanding investors are very important in this to scale up, because it would not have been possible with just our promoter bootstrapping. We would have been stopped at, I think, 1, 2, or maximum 3 hospitals. Second, of course, the ecosystem that has now started working in the favor of these small town hospitals that are high quality are the government payers that are coming in. Hopefully the payment cycles will become shortened in the future. Right now, the payment cycles are the ones that kill most of us. We have payment cycles of some organizations running into years, not months. Third, of course, I think is popularization and the increased awareness of these government schemes that are coming in, because we see that healthcare in India is not just underserved but also under accessed. Right now, we have one of the lowest hospitalization rates in the world. Does not mean, of course, that we are the healthiest, but of course, people do not get access to hospitals or go to the wrong hospitals to get treatment. So I think all these things will make sure that the hospitals have more a muscle to go to the smaller towns rather than getting concentrated in the big cities, which is happening right now.
Perfect. Thank you, Dr. Shuchin. Sandeep, you mentioned you started in Mumbai. You've done work in Ahmedabad. But this question remains of if I were to do this model in 50 cities, what would it take? Where are the headwinds that you're experiencing?
Yeah. So primary care, in our experience, to make it sustainable with an ethical lens is possible if we work on a capitation model, which basically means there is a financer. And I think like what Dr. Shuchin has been also saying, the fact that there is PMJ is what is enabling him to continue ethically and provide care. I think the same thing is required for primary care, because otherwise it's very easy to, in some ways, to make revenue, but then you will defeat the purpose on why it started. I think that's one of the reasons why we also shifted from being a for-profit initially to a not-for-profit now. And I think operating model is clear. The capitation part, if that sustainability is there, it's easy to scale once that is there. It will obviously require some local customizations, particularly on the supply side, because the supply situation of primary care physicians is quite different across India. West and South are very different than North and East and other parts. So with that customization to the budget, etc., it will work out differently, but it can be worked. The provider contract can be made linked to outcomes. You could always have an intermediary organization and not work directly with individual providers. So like an aggregate like Swasth itself saying, there's a network that is managed and then the risk is shared by that organization.
Yeah. So these are excellent ideas. And I think it's worth mentioning or emphasizing to the audience that fee-for-service in tertiary care itself is a problem. It can be even a larger problem in outpatient care because there is a lot of room for information asymmetry. We've seen this in developed countries as well. The moment you subsidize outpatient care, you have co-pays, there is overutilization of healthcare. So we don't want to land up in the same place that other countries have now landed themselves in, and they're trying to change things. Hopefully we can leapfrog. Very good. So, I mean, I'm just keeping track of time. Maybe we can, I think we are almost out of time. It leaves 2 minutes. I don't want to pick a question that then goes unanswered. We have time until 11:40. I want to thank all my panelists again for very patiently answering questions and also engendering a discussion. I think it was fairly interactive. And there are some open questions from the audience. I apologize that we've not been able to address all of them pinpointedly, but most of the themes were touched upon in the conversation. Hopefully, another time, another place, we'll get another opportunity to continue this dialogue forward. Thanks, everyone, and have a great weekend ahead. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.